This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. 52nd Lowland Division 3rd Division Pasha I Ottoman Camels Machine Gun Battalion Strength 14,000 16,000 casualties and losses 1,139,200 including 4,000 prisoners VE Sinai and Palestine Campaign Sinai Suez Canal Jihafa. Qadia Romani Bir el Abid Magdaba Nekel Bir el Hassana Southern Palestine Rafah 1st Gaza 2nd Gaza 1st Southern Palestine Bugger Ridge 2nd Southern Palestine Beersheba Kuwailf 3rd Gaza Herera Huj Magar Ridge Junction Station Ayan Kara Jerusalem Nebi Samuel Jaffa El Burj Judin Hills Tel Asur Barukin Abu Telal 3rd Transjordan JISR Ed Damia 2nd Amman Northern Palestine Arsaf Megiddo Sharon Tulkarm Tabsor 2nd Arara Nazareth Afula. Syria Damascus Urbid Dara JISR Banat Yaqub Kaukab Kiswe Khan Ayash Northern Syria Aleppo Haritan Arab Revolt Mecca Medina Taif Yanbu Aqaba Wadi Musa. Al Samna VE Theatres of World War I European Balkans Western Front Eastern Front Italian Front Middle Eastern Caucasus Persia Gallipoli Mesopotamia Sinai and Palestine Arab Revolt South Arabia African. Southwest Africa Togoland Cameroon East Africa North Africa Asian and Pacific Theatre Naval Theatres U-Boat Atlantic Ocean Mediterranean The Battle of Romani was the last ground attack of the Central Powers on the Suez Canal at the beginning of the Sinai and Palestine Campaign during the First World War. The battle was fought between 3 and 5 August 1916 near the Egyptian town of Romani and the site of ancient Pelusium on the Sinai Peninsula, 23 miles 37. 1915 This British Empire victory, the first against the Ottoman Empire in the war, ensured the safety of the Suez Canal from ground attacks, and ended the Central Powers' ambitions of disrupting traffic through the canal by gaining control of the strategically important northern approaches to the Suez Canal. The pursuit by the Anzac Mounted Division, which ended at Bir el Abid on 12 August, began the Sinai and Palestine Campaign thereafter. The Anzac Mounted Division, supported by the Imperial Camel Brigade, were on the offensive, pursuing the German and Ottoman army many miles across the Sinai Peninsula, reversing in a most emphatic manner the defeat suffered at Qadia 3 months earlier from late April 1916. After a German-led Ottoman force attacked British yeomanry at Qadia, British Empire forces in the region at first doubled from one brigade to two and then grew as rapidly as the developing infrastructure could support them. The construction of the railway and a water pipeline soon enabled an infantry division to join the light horse and mounted rifle brigades at Romani during the heat of summer. Regular mounted patrols and reconnaissance were carried out from their base at Romani, while the infantry constructed an extensive series of defensive redoubts on 19 July. The advance of a large German, Austrian and Ottoman force across the northern Sinai was reported from 20 July until the battle began. The Australian 1st and 2nd Light Horse Brigades took turns pushing out to clash with the advancing hostile column. During the night of 3/4 August 1916, the advancing force including the German Pasha I formation and the Ottoman 3rd Infantry Division launched an attack from Qadia on Romani. Forward troops quickly became engaged with the screen established by the 1st Light Horse Brigade Anzac Mounted Division during fierce fighting before dawn on 4 August. The Australian Light Horsemen were forced to slowly retire at daylight. Their line was reinforced by the 2nd Light Horse Brigade, and about mid-morning, the 5th Mounted Brigade and the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade joined the battle together. These four brigades of the Anzac Mounted Division managed to contain and direct the determined attackers into deep sand. Here the attackers came within range of the strongly entrenched 52nd Lowland Division defending Romani and the railway. Coordinated resistance by all these EEF formations, the deep sand, the heat and thirst prevailed, and the German, Austrian and Ottoman advance was checked. Although the attacking force fought strongly to maintain its positions the next morning, by nightfall they had been pushed back to their starting point at Qadia. The retiring force was pursued by the Anzac Mounted Division between 6 and 9 August, during which the Ottomans and Germans forces fought a number of strong rearguard actions against the advancing Australian Light Horse, British Yeomanry and New Zealand Mounted Rifle Brigades. The pursuit ended on 12 August, when the German and Ottoman force abandoned their base at Bir el Abid and retreated back to El Arish Contents. 1 Background 2 Prelude 21 German and Ottoman Force 22 British Forces 23 Development of Defensive Positions 24 Light Horse Patrols Before the Battle 25 Plans 3 Battle on 4 August 31 Reinforcements 32 Mount Royston Counterattack 4 Battle on 5 August 41 British Capture Wellington Ridge 42 British Advance on Ottoman Rearguard at Katia 5 Pursuit Begins 51 Advance towards Ogrotina 6 August 52 Ogrotina entered on 7 August August 53 Debabis occupied on 8 August 6 Action of Bir el Abid 9 to 12 August. 61 Attack on 9 August 62 Planned attack for 12 August 63 Casualties 7 Aftermath 71 Some criticisms 72 Awards 8 Notes 9 References 10 Bibliography 11 Further reading 12 External links Background map of the Egyptian Sinai Peninsula Bayer R. Rumana as Romani and Al-Quantjara as Kantara at the beginning of the First World War, the Egyptian police controlling the Sinai Peninsula had withdrawn, leaving the area largely unprotected in February 1915, a German and Ottoman force unsuccessfully attacked the Suez Canal. Minor Ottoman and Bedouin forces operating across the Sinai continued to threaten the canal from March through the Gallipoli campaign until June, when they practically ceased until the autumn. Meanwhile, the German and Ottoman empires supported an uprising by the Senussi, a political-religious group on the western frontier of Egypt, which began in November 1915 by February 1916. However, there was no apparent sign of any unusual military activity in the Sinai itself, when the British began construction on the first 25-mile 40. An Ogrotina east of Romani, the Mounted Yeomanry Brigade had been sent to guard the water pipeline and railway as they were being extended beyond the protection of the Suez Canal defences into the desert towards Romani. In response to this attack, the British Empire presence in the region doubled the next day. The New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade and the 2nd Light Horse Brigade, which had served dismounted during the Gallipoli campaign, of the Australian Major General Harry Shovel's Anzac Mounted Division reoccupied the Katia area unopposed. Prelude on the 24th of April, the day after the Katia and Ogrotina, Shovel, commander of the Anzac Mounted Division, was placed in command of all the advanced troops, the 2nd Light Horse Brigade and the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigades at Romani and an infantry division, the 52nd Lowland at Duidar. The infantry moved forward to Romani between the 11th of May and the 4th of June 1916, laying the railway track across the Sinai Desert. The building of the railway and pipeline had not been greatly affected by the fighting on the 23rd of April, and by 29 April, four trains a day were running regularly to the railhead, manned by No. 276 Railway Company, and the main line to Romani was opened on 19 May. A second standard gauge railway line from Romani to Mahamdia on the Mediterranean coast was completed by 9 June, but conditions on the ground were extreme. After the middle of May, and in particular from mid-June to the end of July, the heat in the Sinai Desert ranged from extreme to fierce, when temperatures could be expected to be in the region of 123. Drained 5 million U.S. gallons 19 million. Serbonian Lake, also known as Bardawil Lagoon. Kress von Kressenstein's 4th Army was made up of the 3rd Anatolian Infantry Division's 3 regiments, the 31st, 32nd and 39th Infantry Regiments, totaling 16,000 men, of whom 11,000 to 11,873 were combatants, Arab ancillary forces, and one regiment of the Camel Corps. Estimates of their arms range from 3,293 to 12,000 rifles, 38 to 56 machine guns, and 2 to 5 anti-aircraft gun sections. They also fielded 4 heavy artillery and mountain gun batteries, 30 artillery pieces and the Pasha I formation. Nearly 5,000 camels and 1,750 horses accompanied the advance. The Pasha I formation, with a ration strength of about 16,000, consisted of personnel and materiel for a machine gun battalion of 8 companies with 4 guns each with Ottoman drivers, 5 anti-aircraft groups, the 60th Battalion heavy artillery consisting of 1 battery of 2 100mm guns, 1 battery of 4 150. Romani. The 300th Flight Detachment provided a squadron for aerial reconnaissance, and increased the numbers of aircraft available to support the advance across Sinai. These Pasha I aircraft were faster and more effective than the hopelessly outclassed British aircraft, and were able to maintain air superiority over the battleground. It is also possible that the 81st Regiment of the 27th Division advanced to Bir el Abid and took part in the defense of that place. The objectives of the German, Austrian and Ottoman advance were to capture Romani Sinai and to then establish a strongly entrenched position opposite Kantara, from which place their heavy artillery would be within range of the Suez Canal. The attacking force assembled in the southern Ottoman Empire at Shellal, northwest of Beersheba, and departed for the Sinai on 9 July 1916. They reached Bir el Abed and Ogradina 10 days later. British Forces General Sir Archibald Murray, the commander of the British Empire forces in Egypt, formed the Egyptian Expeditionary Force EEF in March 1916 by merging the force in Egypt, which had protected Egypt since the beginning of the war, with the Mediterranean Expeditionary Force, which had fought at Gallipoli. The role of this new force was to both defend the British Protectorate of Egypt and provide reinforcements for the Western Front. Murray had his headquarters in Cairo to better deal with his multiple responsibilities. Although he was at Ismailia during the battle for Romani with the occupation of Romani, the area became part the northern or number 3 sector of the Suez Canal defenses, which originally stretched along the canal from Ferdin to Port Said. 2 further sectors grouped the defense forces along the central and southern sections of the canal. Number 2, the central sector, stretched south from Ferdin to headquarters at Ismailia and on to Kibrit, where the number 1 or southern sector extended from Kibrit to Suez Ismailia Aerodrome with B-2C two-seater aircraft outside the hangars. Murray considered it very unlikely that an attack would occur anywhere other than in the northern sector and therefore was prepared to reduce the troops in NOS 1 and 2 sectors to a minimum. He decided not to reinforce his 4 infantry brigades, but to increase the available firepower at Romani by moving up the 160th and 161st machine gun companies of the 53rd Welsh and the 54th East Anglian divisions. He also ordered the concentration of a small mobile column made up of the 11th Light Horse, the City of London Yeomanry less 1 squadron each, with the 4th, 6th and 9th companies of the Imperial Camel Brigade in No. 2 sector. He calculated that the whole of the defensive force, including the camel transport necessary to enable infantry in the 42nd East Lancashire Division to advance into the desert, would be fully equipped and the camels assembled by 3 August, approximately 10,000 Egyptian camel transport. Corps camels concentrated at Romani prior to the battle. British monitors in the Mediterranean Sea off Mahamdia got into position to shell the assembling Ottoman force, while an armoured train at Kantara was ready to assist the defence of the right flank, and all available aircraft were on standby at Ismailia, Kantara, Port Said and Romani area. When the railway reached Canterbury Hill, Major General H. A. Lawrence commanded No. 3 Section Canal defences, and as part of those defences, the Romani position was commanded by Lawrence, who had his headquarters at Kantara. Stationed at Kantara were infantry in the 42nd Division, an infantry brigade of the 53rd Welsh Division with 36 guns, and the 3rd Light Horse Brigade, detached from the Anzac Mounted Division. Lawrence moved 2 infantry battalions of the 42nd Division from No. 2 Section Canal defences to Kantara, and sent infantry in the 158th North Wales Brigade of the 53rd Welsh Division to Romani on 20 July. The deployments on 3 August on and near the battle field were as follows: at Hill 70, 12 miles 19. New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade at Dewidar, to the east of Hill 70. This force was to stop or delay von Kressenstein's attack should he attempt to bypass Romani and advance directly towards the Suez Canal. At Hill 40, infantry from the 125th Lancashire Fusiliers Brigade and the 127th Manchester Brigade 42nd Division were also on the railway line at Gilbon Station. The mobile column was based in the Sinai at the end of the Elferdin Railway, while the 3rd Light Horse Brigade was at Ballybunion, also in the Sinai at the end of the Bala Railway. The force at Romani, responsible for its defence when the battle began, consisted of infantry from the British 52nd Lowland Division, commanded by Major General W.E.B. Smith, and the Anzac Mounted Division commanded by Shavel less the 3rd Light Horse Brigade, the 1st and 2nd Light Horse Brigades, less the 5th Light Horse Regiment, but with the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade's Wellington Mounted Rifle Regiment attached, were commanded by Lieutenant Colonels J.B.H. Meredith and J.R. Roy Royston respectively. Development of defensive positions. Romani defences at nightfall 3 August 1916. Infantry from the 52nd Lowland Division joined the 2 mounted brigades at Romani between the 11th of May and the 4th of June, when the development of the railway made it possible to transport and supply such a large number of soldiers. The infantry occupied a defensive position known as Wellington Ridge, facing a tangle of sand dunes. The area favored defense, sand dunes, stretching about 6 miles 97. machine guns allotted to each position. They were well wired on the right side of each of the positions. Although there was no wire between the redoubts, this defensive line was supported by artillery detail of Romani map showing defenses. The threat of an Ottoman attack towards the Suez Canal had been considered by Lawrence in consultation with his divisional commanders, and a second defensive area was developed to address their concerns. Their plans took into account the possibility of an Ottoman army at Katia moving to attack Romani or following the old caravan route to assault Hill 70 and Duidar on their way to the Suez Canal. Any attempt to bypass Romani on the right flank would be open to attack from the garrison, which could send out infantry and mounted troops on the hard ground in the plain to the southwest. The New Zealand Mounted Rifle Brigade was stationed at Hill 70 at the end of June and the 5th Light Horse Regiment at Duidar to prevent such an Ottoman force from reaching the Suez Canal. Light horse patrols before the battle camp at Hill 70 between Duidar and Kantara with shaded horse lines and barbed wire entanglements. Active patrolling by mounted troops continued throughout the period leading up to the battle, but by early July, there were no indications of any imminent resumption of hostilities. The nearest Ottoman garrison of 2,000 men was at Bir el-Mazar, 42 miles 68. Light horse pushed forward, and if a counterattack began, the brigade retired slowly, thereafter to return to camp at Romani at nightfall the following day. The other brigade carried out similar maneuvers in the direction of Katia and the advancing Ottoman columns, picking up the officers' patrols which had been left out during the night to monitor enemy movements during this period. One of many clashes occurred on the 28th of July at Had Ugba, 5 miles 80. Establish a strongly entrenched heavy artillery position opposite Kantara, from which to bombard shipping on the canal. Kress von Kressenstein's plan for the attack on Romani was to bombard the line of defensive redoubts with heavy artillery and employ only weak infantry detachments against them, while his main force launched attacks against the right and rear of the Romani position. Romani defenses at nightfall 3 August 1916. Details of redoubts numbered 1 to 11 and 21 to 23. The defenders expected the German and Ottoman attack to be one of containment against their prepared line of defense, and an all-out attack on the right south of Katib Gannet. They also appreciated that such an attack would expose the German and Ottoman left flank. Murray's plan was to firstly delay the attackers and make it very difficult for them to gain ground south of Katib Gannet, and secondly, only when the German and Ottoman force was totally committed, to then disorganize their flank attack with an attack by section troops at Hill 70 and Duidar, with the 3rd Light Horse Brigade and the Mobile Column operating more widely against the flank and rear. Chauvel had selected a position for the defense of Romani, which stretched for 4 miles 64. Chauvel, the commanders of the 2 light horse brigades, whose task it would be to hold the attackers on this ground until the flank attack could begin, studied the area closely. Battle on 4 August just before midnight. On 3 quarters August, 3 columns of the German Pasha I and the 4th Ottoman Army, consisting of about 8,000 men, began their attack on an outpost line held by the 1st Light Horse Brigade 3.5 hours after the return of the 2nd Light Horse Brigade from their regular daytime patrol, in addition to the usual officers' patrols left out overnight to monitor the enemy's positions. Chauvel decided to leave out for the night the whole of the 1st Light Horse Brigade to hold an outpost line of about 3 miles 48. Positions from the 19th of July to the 9th of August. British lines in red and Ottoman advance and attacks on 3 and the 4th of August in green. The Ottoman center and left columns were skillfully led round the open flank of the infantry's entrenchments and on towards the camp and railway after the moon had set at around 2:30. The Germans and Ottomans made a bayonet charge on Mount Meredith. Although vastly outnumbered, the light horsemen fought an effective delaying action at close quarters, but were forced to relinquish ground slowly and to ultimately evacuate the position by 3 o'clock without the benefit of moonlight. The light horsemen had fired at the flashes of the enemy's rifles until they were close enough to use bayonets. The 1st Light Horse Brigade was eventually forced back, withdrawing slowly, troop covering troop with steady accurate fire, staving off a general attack with the bayonet to their fall-back position. A large east-west sand dune called Wellington Ridge at the southern edge of the Romani encampment. During the retirement to Wellington Ridge, the covering squadrons on the left near Katib Gannet were also attacked, as was the squadron on the right, which was taken in the flank and suffered considerable loss, but managed to hold its ground until the position in its rear was occupied by 3:30. All light horsemen south of Mount Meredith had been forced back to their led horses and had succeeded in disengaging and falling back to their second position soon after. An Ottoman machine gun was shooting down on the light horse from Mount Meredith. Shovel had relied on the steadiness of the 1st Light Horse Brigade, which he had commanded during the Gallipoli campaign, to hold the line against greatly superior numbers for 4 hours until dawn, when the general situation could be assessed. Daylight revealed the weakness of the Light Horse defenders in their second position on Wellington Ridge and that their right was outflanked by strong German and Ottoman forces at 4:30. The 2nd Light Horse Brigade, commanded by Colonel J. R. Royston, was ordered up by Shovel from Etmalar and went into action in front of Mount Royston to support and prolong the 1st Light Horse Brigade's right flank by moving up the 6th and 7th Light Horse Regiments into the front line. German, Austrian or Ottoman artillery now opened fire on the infantry defences and camps in the rear. Shrapnel inflicted some losses, but the high explosive shells were smothered by the soft sand. The attackers succeeded in forcing the Light Horse off Wellington Ridge, which placed them within 700 metres 2,300. Then the 32nd and the 39th Infantry Regiment swung around the left and into the British rear. This outflanking movement was steadily progressing along the slopes of Mount Royston and turning the right of the 2nd Light Horse Brigade, whose 3rd Regiment, the Wellington Mounted Rifles, was now also committed to the front line. The two brigades of Light Horse continued to gradually withdraw, pivoting on the extreme right of the infantry position, which covered the left flank and rear of Romani. They were pushed back between Wellington Ridge and Mount Royston, about 225 miles 362. Watching and harassing an advancing enemy day and night for a fortnight. The fighting in the early morning of the 4th was the weirdest thing I ever took on. It was over rolling sand dunes, and the enemy, who were in thousands, on foot, could see our horses before we could see them in the half-light, and it was awfully difficult to find cover for them. Our losses have been heavy, of course, but absolutely nothing in comparison with what has been achieved. General Shovel's letter to his wife dated the 13th of August. It became apparent that the German and Ottoman right column, 31st Infantry Regiment, was attempting a frontal attack on redoubts held by infantry in the 52nd Lowland Division. The defenders were able to hold on, but were subjected to severe artillery shelling during the day. Frontal attacks began with heavy German or Austrian fire by their artillery, which attempted to breach the infantry defensive line about 8 o'clock. Attacks were being made on numbers 4 and 5 redoubts, which began with heavy artillery fire, but the attacks broke completely when the 31st Ottoman Infantry Regiment were within 150 yards 140. The Light Horse had gradually withdrawn back until, at about 11 o'clock, the main German and Ottoman attack was stopped by well-directed fire from the Royal Horse Artillery batteries of the Anzac Mounted Division and by Light Horse rifle and machine gun fire, to which the 52nd Lowland Division contributed considerable firepower. The attackers appeared to have exhausted themselves, but they held their ground while Austrian and Ottoman artillery of various calibers, including 59 inches and 105. Reinforcements. Chater, commander of the New Zealander Mounted Rifles Brigade, had been advised of the Austrian, German and Ottoman advance against Romani at 2 o'clock by 5:35. Lawrence, at his headquarters of the Northern No. 3 Canal Defences Sector at Kantara, had been informed of the developing attack. He recognised that the main blow was falling on Romani and ordered the 5th Mounted Yeomanry Brigade at Hill 70 to move towards Mount Royston. They were led by a composite regiment, which moved off at once, the remainder of the brigade preparing to follow at 7:25, Lawrence ordered the New Zealand Mounted Rifle Brigade, consisting of Brigade Headquarters and the Canterbury Mounted Rifle Regiment, less the Auckland Mounted Rifles and the attached 5th Light Horse Regiments, 2nd Light Horse Brigade, to move towards Mount Royston via Dewidar and there pick up the Auckland Mounted Rifles Regiment. The Yeomanry and New Zealand Brigades had both been stationed at Hill 70, 12 miles 19. The German, Austrian and Ottoman attack on Mount Royston was checked to the north by the 3rd and 6th Light Horse Regiments, 1st and 2nd Light Horse Brigades, and under constant bombardment from the horse artillery and the infantry's heavy artillery of the 52nd Lowland Division at 10 o'clock, the front held by the two Light Horse Brigades faced south from a point 700 yards 640. Came up on the flank of their mounted regiment, the Royal Gloucestershire Hussars D Squadron, 1,500 yards 1,400. Counterattack at 1400 from the west towards Mount Royston position at 1600 on the 4th of August 1916. The New Zealand riflemen soon gained a footing on Mount Royston, aided by accurate and rapid shooting from the Somerset Royal Horse Artillery Battery by 1600. The attack had proceeded to a point where Chater arranged with the 5th Mounted Brigade for a squadron of Royal Gloucestershire Hussars and two troops of the Worcestershire Yeomanry to gallop against the southern spur of Mount Royston. They easily took the spur. The defenders not not waiting for the onslaught of the mounted charge from the crest of the spur, the Gloucestershire squadron shot down the horse teams of an Austrian, German or Ottoman battery of pack guns concentrated in the hollow behind the spur, and the attacking force began to surrender. The New Zealand Mounted Rifle and 5th Mounted Brigades were supported by leading infantry battalions of the 127th Manchester Brigade, which had just arrived when Ottoman and German soldiers began to surrender en masse at about 1800, 500 prisoners, 2 machine guns and the pack battery were captured, and the outer flank of the attacking force was completely routed. Meanwhile, the inner flank of the German and Ottoman force on Wellington Ridge made a last effort to advance across the ridge, but was driven back by artillery fire. Fresh frontal attacks launched against the main British infantry system of redoubts broke down completely at 1705. Major General Smith ordered infantry in the 156th Scottish Rifles Brigade to attack the enemy force on Wellington Ridge on the left of the Light Horse, and in coordination with the counterattack on Mount Royston, an artillery bombardment of Wellington Ridge began at 1845, just before 1900. Infantry in the 7th and 8th Cameronian Scottish Rifles moved south from behind No. 23 Redoubt, the 8th Scottish Rifles advancing to within 100 yards 91. Battle on 5 August. Within 24 hours, British commanders were able to concentrate a force of 50,000 men in the Romani area, a 3-to-1 advantage. This force included the 2 infantry divisions, the 52nd and the newly arrived 42nd, 4 mounted brigades, 2 of which had been on active duty since 20 July, and 2 heavily engaged on the front line the day before, and may have included the 3rd Light Horse Brigade, although it was still at Hill 70, and the mobile column at Had El Bada at this time. Command of the 5th Mounted Brigade passed from the Anzac Mounted Division to the Infantry Division, the 42nd Division, it being suggested that orders required the Anzac Mounted Division to remain in position, and that the 3rd Light Horse Brigade alone was to make a flank attack. However, Lawrence's orders for a general advance on 5 August beginning at 4 o'clock included an advance by the Anzac Mounted Division. His orders read, "Anzac Mounted Division to press forward with its right on the Had El Enna and its left in close touch with the infantry from the 156th Scottish Rifles Brigade, 52nd Lowland Division, advancing on the line Khatib Gannet to Mount Meredith, 3rd Light Horse Brigade to move towards Bir el Nus and attack Had el Enna from the south, keeping in close touch with the Anzac Mounted Division, 5th Mounted Brigade, under orders of 42nd Infantry Division to assist the 3rd Light Horse Brigade's link with the Anzac Mounted Division's right, 42nd Division to move on the line Canterbury Hill Mount Royston Had el Enna and drive back any opposition to the advance of the mounted troops in close support of Anzac Mounted Division's right flank, 52nd Lowland Division to move in close support of Anzac Mounted Division's left flank towards Mount Meredith, and to prepare for a general advance towards Abu Hamra, which was not to be undertaken until further orders from Lawrence at No. 3 Section Headquarters. Note 10. Meanwhile, the German, Austrian and Ottoman force was now spread from Hill 110 almost to Bir and Nus, but with their left flank unprotected they could not have been in good shape after fighting all the previous day in intense midsummer heat and having to remain in position overnight, far from water and harassed by British infantry. Their situation was now precarious, as their main attacking force was well past the right of the main British infantry positions. Infantry in the 52nd Lowland Division was closer to the nearest enemy-controlled water source at Katia than most of the attacking force. Had the British infantry left their trenches promptly and attacked in a southeasterly direction, von Kressenstein's force would have had great difficulty escaping British capture Wellington Ridge.